It's not that difficult. You got to stop putting stuff on Twitter from your head to your keyboard, bro. You've got to stop doing it. You sound like an idiot, bro. That's not funny. It wouldn't even be funny if a child said that, and you're not a child. God, bro, I'm begging you, please don't give us 1,000 reasons to put you on this show every week. That is so freaking stupid, man. It's not funny. There's not a shred of humor in that. Not a shred.
And once that bell rings, he is just doing a match.
Shut up. Shut up, you clueless dweeb. Shut up. Because it doesn't matter that he is great until the bell rings. Because guess what, Jeff? They already paid the money to see him. Does Alvarez not understand that? God, I swear to God, bro, I get so hot because it blows my mind that they don't understand the business that they're covering. They don't understand it.
I mean, why is Jedi Master sour? Why is he pointing to Brian Alvarez's ding-dong?
Why is he pointing to Brian Alvarez's, you know, yock and floster?
Well, this Ryan Satin tweet sent by...
Oh, come on with Ryan Satin, Jeff! Who sent in all these Ryan Satin tweets?
I hate this. I so hate this, man. I really do. Go ahead.
Does he not understand? Nobody gives a flying you-know-what about Seth Rollins. They're going to be pissed off that Reigns won. They're going to boo Reigns out of the building. But the fact that Rollins hugs Reigns and then points at the sun and says, go get him. Bro, can you imagine people are paying money for this wisdom?
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, it is you who wakes me up every day. And I am forever grateful for your love. This is why I pray. You let me touch so many people. And it's all for the good. I influenced so many children. I never thought that I would. And I couldn't take credit for the love they get. Because it all comes from you, Lord. I'm just the one that's giving it. And when it seems like the pressure gets to be too much, I take time out and pray and ask that you be my crutch. Lord, I am not perfect by a long shot. I confess to you daily. But I work hard every day and I hope that you hear me. In my heart, I mean well. But if you'll help me to grow, then what I have in my heart will begin to show. And when I get going, I'm not looking back for nothing. Because I will know where I'm headed. And I'm so tired of the suffering. I stand before you, a weakened version of your reflection. Begging for direction, for my soul needs resurrection. I don't deserve what you've given me, but you never took it from me. Because I am grateful, and I use it, and I do not worship money. If what you want from me is to bring your children to you, my regret is only having one life to do it, instead of two. Amen.
What's up, everybody? Welcome into episode 95 of the Josh Lopez Wrestling Podcast right here at Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, YouTube, wherever you get your podcast from. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel. It's youtube.com/Josh Lopez Wrestling Podcast. Subscribe there. Subscribe on iTunes. Leave us a 4 or 5 star review rating. Tell a friend about the podcast. We truly appreciate it. It's your boy, Josh Lopez. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at NotoriousJoshy. Make sure to check out the Facebook page, facebook.com/JWL Podcast. Bookmark, ProWrestlingTranscriptions.com. That's my website. That's where I do all my play-by-play articles for the world of professional wrestling. And, boy, do we got a doozy today. We got a doozy today. There's a lot of things that are going to come off my chest, and I want to make this perfectly clear. At the end of the day, I'm a wrestling fan just like you. I'm not an analyst. I'm not an expert. Any this or that. No. I'm a fan at the end of the day, just like you guys. And as much as I am a part of you guys as the fans and the community, I'm very disappointed of where we are as a fan base in this entire wrestling landscape. I am. And I've talked about that in the past. And I'm coming in from a different angle this week. I have 2 questions for you guys as you listen to this podcast. You're listening to it right now here on Apple Podcasts. The 2 questions that I'm going to throw your way this week is, one, what constitutes being a professional wrestling fan in 2018? Not what constitutes being a real professional wrestling fan. I'm just talking about being a regular fan. What comes with being a wrestling fan in 2018? Because after all these big 4 pay-per-view weekends or pay-per-views that doesn't have the conclusions that you want or the winners that you want, and there's all this vitriol throughout social media, the question I always come with from my end is, what are we doing here? Why are we watching? With the most of venom that's spewed throughout the days after pay-per-views. Because Roman Reigns supposedly is the cancer of all things wrestling. And even though we talk about long-term storytelling and they go with it, it's too predictable. And all these other scenarios you hear on a gazillion wrestling podcasts. That's the first question. The second question is, why would Ronda Rousey or any female need a man to speak for them? And if you notice that my tone's starting to get more serious, there's a reason behind that. I'm pissed off right now. And if the reason you think I'm pissed off is something that happened this past Friday, no. I'm above that shit, and I'm not going to talk about it. This is something different, and it affects me personally. Because what's the reason we're doing this? What's the reason we watch this stuff? What's the reason why we go out of our way to spend money and go to WrestleManias and go to all these shows like a Raw or SmackDown? Or hell, even go to other wrestling companies that's not named WWE. What do we do? What is our goal here in 2018? What is our goal in this society, in this era of wrestling we're living in? What is our goal? And that's what I'm trying to figure out. This podcast is about providing a platform for wrestling fans to not be ridiculed to feeling bad about the product. I'm not going to make you feel bad because, oh, you like the wrestling and I don't. That's not where I'm coming from with this. Everybody that listens to this podcast each week, everybody knows the theme of this show. I don't need to repeat it to you guys. I say it every time you listen to the show. For those who are listening for the first time, I appreciate you giving this podcast a chance. And I'm sorry that I'm coming off with a more serious tone. And this is how the show is going to be this week. But I'm speaking from the heart. And whether you like me or not, and whether you agree or disagree with my opinions, that's fine. I'm appreciative for people that want to take the time to listen to what I have to say. Because at the end of the day, what I say or what anybody else says on these shows or so-called media networks, it doesn't mean shit at the end of the day. We're wrestling fans. Nothing we say on these shows matter. I come out here and crack jokes and give out advice and just be myself, right? And everything I say comes from context and substance, not just reactionary shit that spews off the top of my head. I don't work like that. And I'm different. When I'm covering a wrestling show live, for, let's say like a Raw, right? I'm not going through everything that's going through my mind from a booking standpoint while I'm watching the show live. That's how I separate from other people. I don't need to have every thought that's spewing through my head on a social media. Nobody should want to know what goes through my mind. But going back to the first question I was posing earlier, and we're going to get into Elimination Chamber and Raw and SmackDown because there's a lot of positive stuff I want to get to in this week's podcast. And I'm saving those for separate segments. But the beginning of this podcast, I'm going off. And I'm going off for a reason. Because I'm disappointed of where we are as a fan base right now. I am. You know, it's one thing to be annoyed where you have former wrestlers or personalities like a Vince Russo or Taz or Jim Cornette or whatever spewing off at the mouth or whatever and making wrestling fans feel bad about watching the product. He says, fine, whatever, that's their opinion. That stuff doesn't matter to me. But when it gets to the point where you're watching a show or watching a product and because one person and one decision affects a pay-per-view that was pretty good this past Sunday, and this outburst of venom and vitriol and nonsense and bullshit that comes out of people's mouths sometimes takes the fun out of this for me. It really does. And as any good broadcaster that does this for a living, they look at both sides of the table. There's a reason why I dropped this podcast on Fridays. I listen to 6 different wrestling podcasts a week before I do my own. 6. It would be 7, but another podcast is starting to do their new show on Monday, and that show is called Rant With Ant, which you can follow them at Twitter at Rant With Ant and check out their shows on Apple Podcasts because they have a very good show. I listen to 6 different wrestling podcasts, talk show / radio shows. And there's shows that are positive, there's shows that are negative. I don't need to give them the list to you. But I listen to both sides of the fence, contrary to what you may think of me. I do listen to the other side. I listen to the more skeptical people and have their vitriols about booking and all their other minuscule stuff. I do listen to that stuff, and maybe I can relate or rationalize to that stuff, but for those that listen to this podcast, you guys know damn well, if there's something that I don't like, and I hate using that word, I hate the word if there's something I don't like about the product, I'm not going to talk about it. There's a point where we need to understand as a society that wasted energy and things that don't matter should not affect the way we go about our shows. Okay, you want to complain about something? Have some substance to it, at least. Don't just bitch the bitch. Because I could listen to 90 other wrestling podcasts go through the same format and the same style and the same voice and the same formats and everything sounds the same. There's no substance to what's going on right now. And then you go on social media after a pay-per-view because, God forbid, Roman Reigns, who by the way, if we want to be so serious about the win-loss records and booking now these days, a guy who's lost multiple matches on television, has lost pay-per-view matches, hasn't been a world champion in over almost 2 years. This guy gets thrust with, oh, he's being shoved down our throats again. He's being shoved down our throats again. Him closing out the show with The Undertaker last year had nothing to do with him. I don't know what's so hard about that to understand. That WrestleMania 33 was about The Undertaker supposedly having his final send-off. It had nothing to do with Roman Reigns. It didn't have to do with this propaganda bullshit of, oh, he's being shoved down our throats, and WWE doesn't have the finger on the pulse of what their fans want. I don't understand that point of view, because this guy that supposedly doesn't have charisma, doesn't have top guy charisma, this guy can't bring in a ring, he can't perform unless he has a guy from the indies carrying him during the match. All this stuff you hear about Roman Reigns, right? And then he's John Cena 2.0. And this guy is so shoved down your throat that he hasn't been a world champion in 2 years. And because he closed out the show with The Undertaker, yet The Undertaker was the last thing you saw on that show in Orlando last year. And I was there in Orlando in that dump of a stadium in person to witness it. That main event was not a coronation of Roman Reigns. You didn't have him go sit on a throne as WrestleMania was going off with pyro and ballyhoo. Yeah, there were fireworks, but what closed that show last year? The three gongs representing what was supposed to be the end of The Undertaker, or at least to what will happen in a couple weeks. It's just frustrating. I get it. I would understand if you just were upfront to say you don't like the guy and you hate him, instead of coming around with these wraparound narratives about, oh, he's good, he could do this, but he's not reliable. He has allegations about steroids. He's not dependable like John Cena. He doesn't get the job done. When you need to rely on him, he fails. Really? He has no connection to the crowd. No, it's just the kids and the women. No men like him, right? There's a friend of mine that I met a couple months ago sent me a picture of his closet filled with Roman Reigns vests and gloves and t-shirts and posters. Now, he's not an obsessed fan over the guy, but he has a lot of respect for him like I do. And what I don't understand about this society we're in right now and this fan... it's not even the community. that's the funny thing about this. We talk about communities and families, and we need to come together as a wrestling community, and we need to better ourselves. And there's this thing called wrestling Twitter now, which is so fucking stupid. The reason why I don't run in certain circles in the wrestling media, guys, is because I don't have to. I have my own voice. I am my own person. I have friends that are in the wrestling media. There are people in the wrestling media that I respect. But at the same time, I don't go through what they say as the gospel truth. And I'm fine having conversations and debates with them. That's perfectly fine. But this mentality, if you don't have this certain mindset and you don't fit this certain criteria as a fan, oh, you're a shill, you're a stan, you're this, you're that. It's just annoying. And then people throw out this nonsense of, oh, people think they're higher and bigger than they really are. This is podcasting. We're not gimmicks. We're not wrestlers. We're not workers. Nobody's acting like they're bigger than anything. Well, maybe that's not true. Not at least for me. I don't think I'm above anybody. I don't think that I'm better than anybody. Do I call myself the student in the game? Yes, but that's because that's my life model. Not because I think I'm better than people. I want to have fun with this. I get genuinely excited to come on here and talk to you guys each week and give you my thoughts on the product and see where things go. And maybe I could help you have a better day and change your mind on something and maybe add some light to some negative energy that's coming your way. And I want this show to be an escape for you guys to remind ourselves why we have fun with this in the first place. Why we watch. What constitutes being a wrestling fan in 2018? Every time before WrestleMania, there's always some decision that's going to act like the world's going to come to an end. And then we need to come up with this asinine theory of how we could have a triple threat match because we need to save what's left of WrestleMania. And it's just really annoying. Just say you hate the guy. And one match out of whatever going to be a number of matches on a six-hour show is going to be that bad that you're going to cancel your network and cancel your trip to WrestleMania. That's the point you need to realize that this show and this company is not for you. I'm not saying that you're not supposed to watch wrestling anymore because you don't like the WWE. But my point is Roman Reigns really that much of a crutch for you to not enjoy the product when we have all these other great performers on the show? Roman Reigns is not even my favorite wrestler on the show, but I damn sure respect him. I am a fan of his. I love his matches. And don't tell me he doesn't have a connection to the crowd, because we have fucking bozos at a pay-per-view booing them out of the building, but this guy puts in awesome match of the night quality matches on Raw every single week that has This Is Awesome chance, but you're telling me that he can't bring it when it matters the most, and he fails, and he doesn't hit the ball in the ballpark. Because, why? Because he doesn't have Danny Bryan. Yes! 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 Give me a fucking break. This guy doesn't have any connection with the audience. Stop. Second thing, before we get to the Ronda topic, there's one thing in wrestling that I can't stand the most, and it's not even booking or social media stuff. This is something that really ticks me off. Disrespecting the talents while they're performing. That's the main thing that pisses me off. To whoever brought six fucking beach balls to the T-Mobile Arena this past Sunday, you should be ashamed of yourself. Look, I'm not going to begrudge a fan that may not be interested in a certain program and you want to sit in your hands, you want to be quiet and do this and that. Fine. But going on your way to play beach balls and do the waves and chant for wrestlers who are not even involved in this match or commentators, it's just flat out disrespectful and ignorant. And for anybody to promote the notion that woke Matt Hardy is horrible and that he sucks? What? Are you kidding me? He sucks. He doesn't bring anything to the table. Okay, I'm going to go for your expertise, and you're going to tell me that Matt Hardy doesn't have the ability to draw you in today's wrestling. Give me a break. And lastly, and it comes to the Ronda Rousey topic, and this is probably the most important thing I'm going to talk about here today. Why would a man need to speak for a woman? We have Ronda make her debut this past Sunday at the Elimination Chamber. And what's everybody talking about? Oh, we need to get Paul Heyman to speak for her. We need Paul Heyman to be our advocate. We need to have Ronda presented and booked the same way as Brock Lesnar. You know, the same people that go out of their way to tell you every single week that WWE doesn't come up with creative things. They want us to have Paul Heyman be the advocate for Ronda because that's really original in 2018. What really ticks me off about that is that these are the same people that cry wolf about the women's revolution and having equality and women deserve this and women deserve that, and that we need four women's matches at WrestleMania. I always be an advocate for women's wrestling. I'll always be an advocate for women going out of their way to succeed despite of what they are, despite what their background is, despite what other men think of them. Women can do anything they want in this world. I have an older sister that's lesbian, and she can do anything she wants. I'm very happy and proud of her that she found her escape and her freedom and got to move the hell out of Chicago. I'm happy for her. I'm proud of the woman she is. I'm proud that the company is going out of their way to put this emphasis on the women. And, okay, Ronda Rousey comes from the MMA world. But you're going to tell me that Ronda Rousey, because she doesn't have the exterior mic skills after her first two shows, we already need to attach a guy to her so she could come off as a better character. I just don't know how we come to these rash conclusions on performers, especially after their debuts, where they came from NXT or they come from another company, this or that. Again, going back to the original question, what constitutes being a wrestling fan in 2018? Because don't tell me about equality in that the WWE doesn't come up with creative storylines and creative presentations, and then the next second, you're telling me that Paul Heyman needs to be an advocate for Ronda Rousey. That's bullshit. That's bullshit. And you know that damn well. I don't want to hear any excuses. I thought Ronda did fine on the mic. You know, God forbid, show some damn compassion and passion for what you do on the mic, right? Oh, they're watering her down. This doesn't seem real. I don't remember Ronda being this massive shit talker in USC. She did her business. She came into the ring with a stone face and the death stare. That was it. You know, anytime you ever listen to her in an interview setting or press conference, she was just her and humbled. But you hit the right trigger point, then she gets pissed off. I like what's going on with her. I'm interested in this tag team match. I want to see what happens. But to say that after two shows that she desperately needs Paul Heyman to be her advocate. I love and respect Paul Heyman before anybody puts words in my mouth. I love and respect that guy. I don't give a shit about Brock Lesnar anymore, and I made that perfectly clear last year. I don't care for Brock Lesnar. He could go home as far as I'm concerned. I'm sick of him. But the people that talk about WWE is not good with storytelling and coming up with original angles, these are the same people that are going to go out of their way and tell you that Ronda Rousey, a woman, a beacon, and one of the reasons why we have this women's revolution in the first place, they're going to tell you that she needs a man to speak for her in order to get whatever we need to get the best out of her character in this setting. And that's bullshit. That's bullshit. That's not right. That's ignorant. That's sexist. That's just wrong. She can speak for herself. Women can speak for themselves. Women can do what they want to do. Women can find their ways to be top performers on their own. They don't need a man to do that for them. I'm disappointed, guys. I really am. From the dumb threats every time after a pay-per-view of, oh, we're going to cancel our network and watch Raw the next night, to this stuff with Ronda Rousey and people wanting to get Roman Reigns suspended and allegations, and every time we don't get our way after the Royal Rumble or the Elimination Chamber, we always need to make a triple threat for the main event of WrestleMania. I'm just disappointed, guys. I really am. Because we're supposed to have fun with this. And I really think we're in for a really fun WrestleMania this year. And we got to make it about stuff that really doesn't matter at the end of the day. And we got to feed our own egos. And that's a shame. That's a damn shame. Ronda Rousey. needs a man to speak for. Give me a fucking break. And with that, that's my monologue this week. We have a lot more positive stuff to talk about coming on the other side of this podcast. Let's take a look at this past week's Elimination Chamber right here on the Josh Lopez Wrestling Podcast.
Gallows and Anderson, earlier today we were joking around on Facebook Live. You guys were pretty confident, though, that you were going to win tonight on the kickoff show against the Miz Taraj. What does a win like that tonight mean for you guys?
See, that is what Carl Anderson and the Big LG are all about. That is why we came to the WWE on these enormous downsides. That is what we do. That's what we've done worldwide. And that's why we came here, because of what you just saw. Bo Dallas, Curtis Axel, you guys were just the beginning of the rebirth of the boys in the WWE.
I don't mean to be the bearer of bad news, but after your match, the Revival actually went and were interviewed on the kickoff show and said that you guys make a mockery of the tag team division and that that match was actually a joke.
Mockery. I'll handle this one, good brother. You want to talk about tag team legacies? You want to talk about tag team dynasties? There are three tag teams in history who have been IWGP Tag Team Champions and WWE Tag Team Champions. They are the Steiner Brothers, the Dudley Boys, who we retired, and the GNA Express, Carl Anderson and Luke Gallows. So you want to talk about tag teams? How about them accolades? How about them accolades?
Talk about them. Exactly, Kathy. We don't care what the Revival said. We've beaten them before, and we'll beat them again. That's what
and
we do.
And one more thing.
Give it to them.
How about the Revival? They're na-na-na-na, na-na-na-na. Na 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 na, they're nerds.
What an incredible night it has been, you guys. Kathy Kelly here for WWE Now. Now, we kicked off the night with the first ever women's elimination.
The downward spiral of deletion for Bray Wyatt and Sister Abigail has begun. I don't know if you know this, Kathy Kelly, but Sister Abigail is older than my inner essence, Zenith, and more powerful. But tonight, for the vessel of Bray Wyatt, it has started. It has begun. It is on its way to being over! Delete!
Finn, going into the match tonight, it seemed like you had the entire WWE universe in your corner. Does that add to the disappointment of not leaving tonight victorious?
Yeah, obviously, it adds to the disappointment. Huge opportunity at stake tonight, lost. The chance to go to WrestleMania to challenge Brock Lesnar for the championship that I never lost goes away. But don't get me wrong, I've been chasing that title since I had to relinquish it the day after SummerSlam over a year ago. The chase will continue. You can't wipe the smile off this face with just one loss.
Listen, the thing is, you know, everybody needs to be managed, okay? And while things got a little bit out of hand tonight, I know that tomorrow night on Monday Night Raw, Kurt Angle needs to apologize, I think, for his actions. I don't know where he came up with half of the things he said tonight. And then, you know, Ronda Rousey will... She has some explaining to do, but I think Ronda just got all worked up by
well,
Kurt.
Well, Steph, we actually want to just take a look at this clip really quickly, if you don't mind, of exactly
well,
when this
for,
moment
thank you for cutting me off, Renee, but that's fine.
Picked up for you.
Whoa, Stephanie, one last thing. Didn't you tell me in your office that Ronda was a has-been and that even you could take her? Didn't you say that?
Stephanie, what kind of validity is there to that question?
Well, there's no validity to that statement at all. And that's what I said. Kurt Angle is going to have to apologize tomorrow night. And Ronda, I think, just, you know, she obviously believed what Kurt Angle had to say. She got swept up in the emotions of the evening. She's going to have to do some explaining. But listen, this is what you guys don't understand, okay? I am a leader. I am the boss. Ronda Rousey signed her contract, which means she now reports to me. And so does Kurt Angle. So as their manager, I'm just going to have to remind them of their roles in WWE. And that's okay, because I'm good at my job. You know your role. Renee, you know your role. right? And everybody's perfectly happy. So I just need to educate Ronda a little bit and, you know, help smooth out some of those rough edges.
Welcome back to the podcast, everybody. I do want to apologize for any noises in the background. that's out of my control. We got bad vents in the house, so sometimes the air keeps going on for about 2 or 3 minutes or so. So hopefully it's not that bad. As long as you hear the sound of my voice, then we're all good. Hopefully it's not too distracting. Welcome back to the podcast, and more on a positive light than our previous segment. Talk a little bit about the Elimination Chamber. As for those that listen to the podcast, though, I did not break down every segment or match, but I'll give you my overall bullet point thoughts on the Chamber pay-per-view as a whole. I thought the show was good from top to bottom, just for multiple factors. I thought the Women's Elimination Chamber match was really, really good. I thought they spaced out the entrances and the eliminations right. I thought it was a nice coming out party for Absolution, who don't have a lot of experience in the ring, and both are former Tough Enough participants. But they had a really good showing, and I think the future is very bright for both Mandy Rose and Sonya Deville. I thought Mickey had another awesome performance. She's definitely a first ballot Hall of Famer, and it's not close. We had the angle going on with Sasha Banks and Bayley of who's hurting on who. And then, of course, we had, of course, the goddess and the hottest woman on Raw, Alexa Bliss. And she ended up retaining the Raw Women's Championship. And WWE put an interesting video about Alexa Bliss's day heading into the Elimination Chamber pay-per-view that just posted about an hour ago on the YouTube channel before I started recording this podcast. So go check that out. It's about a 6-minute video. It's very good. Again, Buddy Murphy, man, you are one lucky SOB, man. That girl is freaking hot. But more importantly, I think, and I said this before, Alexa Bliss is literally the best character for the Raw Women's Division right now, and I'm very happy for her that she's able to go into another WrestleMania as champion, and that shows true testament of how good a performer she is, because last year she went on SmackDown Live as an unknown in the draft and went into WrestleMania as champion, and same thing happened here on Raw. That's just a testament of how good this girl is, whether you want to admit it or not. Alexa Bliss is just that damn good. And evidence is shown off of that promo after that match was over. I'm very happy for Alexa Bliss that she's getting the opportunity to go to WrestleMania as Raw Women's Champion. She deserved it. She put in the work in. She busted her ass, and she earned that spot. So I'm very happy for Alexa Bliss. Other stuff on the show in program, yes. I thought the club were fine in the kickoff show. I hope you enjoyed that promo I played before the segment. I thought that was really, really funny. The Bar Retainer Raw tag team titles over Titus Worldwide, which I thought was a fine match. It was a nice outing for Titus and Apollo Crews that they've been getting their opportunity. And then, of course, they followed up with the 2 out of 3 falls match on Raw the next night. I thought the matches were fine. You can call it filler, but I thought for the time they had on the pay-per-view, I think they made the best of it. And I really like the Bar's finishing move, which is that diving clothesline white noise combination. I don't know if they have a specific name for that finisher, but I'll have to look into that, but the Bar are still your Raw Tag Team Champions, which leaves things up the air for the Raw Tag Team Division going into WrestleMania. What do the Bar do at WrestleMania? I pose the idea of possibly them having a 3-way with the Revival and the Club, which would be perfectly fine. Usually on WrestleManias, you do have a Fatal 4-Way or some type of match like that for the tags. And that's kind of the thing with WrestleMania now these days. With how deep the roster is, it's not that you can't tell good one-on-one stories for that show, but you have people who are very talented and are very important cogs to your programming, and they do deserve spots on that WrestleMania card. And, you know, yeah, you may have a lot of multi-person type of matches or whatever, but so either way, it'd probably be a club revival and bar three-way match, which is interesting. You have a team called the Bar, the Club, and some type of Evolution, where three tag teams named that way. But all three tag teams are very talented in their own right, so I think they all deserve a chance to be on WrestleMania. And WrestleMania has evolved a lot over the years, and it's a topic I heard in other podcasts this week that people are kind of losing the purpose of what WrestleMania actually is. I mean, when you look at the first WrestleMania back in 85, it was, you had Liberace, you had Mr. T, you had all these other celebrities and stuff on that show. And for hardcore wrestling fans like myself that likes the in-ring content and stuff, the main two matches on that show was Andre the Giant and Big John Studd and who could body slam each other first in a random tag team match with Hogan and Mr. T against Piper and Paul Orndorff. So there's a wrestling company out there in Los Angeles called PWG, Pro Wrestling Guerrilla, and their WrestleMania show is Bola, and that's being indie show, and they have a lot of good in-ring technical wrestling, and that's what they base their show on. WrestleMania is very different in a lot of ways because it's a show for casual fans that watch the show and have fun for what it is. You know, not a lot of people watch wrestling a lot. There's people that just watch WrestleMania every year just because of the brand it is and how it's marketed and how it reaches out to other people. And I think that's very cool. I've been fortunate enough to go to a couple of WrestleManias. I got to cover a WrestleMania in California a couple of years ago, which was really cool, in Santa Clara in 2015. And, you know, I got to pay for my own trip to WrestleMania last year in Orlando. And that was really cool, especially for me, where I was with my age and, you know, not having to depend on parents to pay for trips and stuff or vacations. I thought that was a lot of fun. And I enjoyed that trip in Orlando. I thought I had a blast. And WrestleMania is a show, it's based on having fun. This is the biggest celebration for the WWE throughout the year. It really is. If I wanted the in-ring, like, marquee matches, and that's all it was, like, the Wrestle Kingdom of WWE, I would watch SummerSlam. If I want fun, I want spectacle, I want Ballyhoo, I just want to have a good time, this is WrestleMania. This is the culmination of a years-long worth of programs. Yeah, there's some feuds that end, there's some feuds that begin, but this is a celebration show. This is not Wrestle Kingdom. This is WrestleMania. And WrestleMania is not Bola, and it's not Ultima Lucha, and it's not even Bound for Glory. This is WrestleMania. And there's reasons why certain performers are on the show and positioned in the way they are. Think about this. Bret Hart was in the company for WrestleMania 2 in Chicago in 86. He didn't get his first title opportunity for the WWE till 1993. Think about that. 7 different WrestleManias that Bret Hart had to be in the mid-card or a tag team division before he got a title shot. I think that's stuff people forget about these days. Hell, even Shawn Michaels, he was in a tag team for 5 years before he got his shot at titles and this and that. WrestleMania is a very pop culture-centric show. It's not for hardcore fans like you and me. And that's kind of the frustrating part about this, because, you know, you go on social media and you're like, oh, why don't they make matches have this meaning like they do in New Japan? Well, New Japan does what they do. WWE does what they do. Like, you have this narrative about wrestling companies having their own logic. They're allowed to have their own logic. It's an entertainment platform. They could provide any content they want the way they want to. And whether people like wrestling or not, they still find a way to watch. WWE had its highest revenue in company history this past year. Think about that. It's crazy. So WrestleMania is a big part of that. And, you know, yeah, you're going to have a lot of multi-people matches on that show, but those people deserve an opportunity to be on that show. So other stuff on the Elimination Chamber that stood out to me, I thought Nia Jax and Asuka had a very good match, way better than their NXT TakeOver London match. No, it wasn't London. No, was that? I know they fought on one TakeOver. I know that's for sure. I thought Nia and Asuka had a very good match. And then I talked about it earlier in my rant earlier about the beach ball Nimrods. And you're at a wrestling show. Why are you going to be bouncing beach balls around the arena like that? That's just disrespecting the performers. So I thought that was very interesting. But also at the same time, we had, the main event of the show. And that was a very physical and a very, very entertaining match from top to bottom. And Braun Strowman had a very good outing. He eliminated a record 5 guys in the Elimination Chamber match, which is hasn't been done since Goldberg. No, I think Goldberg had 4, I think. Goldberg had 4 and won that SummerSlam Chamber match. And Braun had his good outing. But, again, just because one match didn't go the way you wanted to, or the match was good. Don't give me this crap. Just because Roman Reigns won the match, the match sucked. That's stupid. That's stupid. That's like saying a movie that you liked was really good, but because it didn't have the right ending you expect or whatever, that makes it a bad movie. Come on. That's dumb. You're already invested a certain amount of time in a match or a movie, and if you're enjoying it, don't let one little thing affect that. That's so stupid. And again, I come from a different standpoint. I'm a Roman Reigns fan. It just is what it is. throw your arrows at me. Tell me that I'm not a real wrestling fan because I'm a Roman Reigns fan. Whatever. I don't care. But that's just my opinion about it. So Roman Reigns is the winner of the Elimination Chamber, and he will take on Brock Lesnar at WrestleMania. So overall, I enjoyed the Chamber pay-per-view. But again, we can't have fun with this. We had people go on post shows and this and that saying, I'm just disappointed. I'm going to cancel my network subscription. I'm going to cancel my trip to WrestleMania. And I just think that's ridiculous. So going back to my main question for this week's podcast, what constitutes a wrestling fan in 2018? So, overall, I enjoyed Elimination Chamber. Was it the best pay-per-view or anything like that? Was that the best Chamber pay-per-view I saw of all time? No. But it was worth the time I put into covering that show live this past Sunday. So, I enjoyed the Chamber. Let me know your thoughts at Twitter, at NotoriousJosh. What did you think about the Elimination Chamber pay-per-view this past Sunday? And do you like the fact that Alexa Bliss and Roman Reigns are heading into WrestleMania in title matches? So, love to get your thoughts on that. We're going to take our next break right now. And when we come back, we'll be recapping this past week's SmackDown Live.
What was that? What was that? Where did he come from? How did he get you like that? 1 second, I'm about to take out Baron Corbin. And then what a surprise.
How's it going, guys?
Okay, are you kidding me? Did you see what happened out there? Did you see what just happened?
Yep.
Oh, I see how it is. Listen, I see how it is.
Listen, before you guys start going off on another conspiracy thingy, excuse me, listen up. Daniel Bryan just left, okay? And I suggest you guys go after him and catch up with him because, Bree doesn't like when you guys are all late for dinner. Have a good night.
It never ends! It never ends with this guy!
Bobby, last week Shane McMahon made it official at WWE Fastlane. You will be putting your United States Championship on the line against the Viper, Randy Orton.
For the very first time, I'm excited. Like I've said before, I want to be the greatest United States Champion in history. In order for me to do that, I need to test myself against the very best. And in my opinion, Randy Orton is one of the greatest WWE superstars of all time. Even though he seems to have a bit of an issue with me as of late. After everything that Randy has done in his career, everything that he's accomplished, it certainly couldn't be the fact that I ranked higher than him on the SmackDown Superstars Top 10 list.
It's not about the list, Bobby. It's about that title. The United States Championship is the only title that I haven't got my hands on in 16 years. So, you just so happen to be the guy I gotta run through to take it.
With WrestleMania season in full swing, your boys, the New Day, are looking to secure our position on the grandest stage of them all.
But first, Fastlane, where we take on our greatest rivals. I'm talking about two guys who pushed us to the limit. From Money in the Bank all the way to Hell in a Cell, I think you know who I'm talking about.
Who?
I'm talking about Jay and Jim, the Usos.
And oh boy, that rivalry is hotter than my inner thighs in the summer.
And in less than 2 weeks, we're gonna do it again. Because last week we defeated Benjamin and Gable in order to become first in line at an opportunity at the WWE World Tag Team Championship.
Yeah. Now, everybody knows we respect the Usos. We respect them, no doubt. But this isn't about respect. This is about winning. And at Fastlane, when we win, we gonna make our way down to the Big Easy, New Orleans. We gonna party on Bourbon Street, get to Millie rocking and a twerking and swiveling our hips with the entire WWE Universe. And do you know why?
Because!
Talk about the power of positivity? Well, here's a dose of the reality. For the past 9 years, me and Noose been right here grinding. For the past 9 years, a whole bunch of blood, sweat, and tears been poured right in the middle of this ring, Noose. For the past 9 years, we try to prove to everybody that the Usos belong on WrestleMania. That's just it. WrestleMania. Year after year, we've been getting passed over. New Day versus the Usos, and we're about to run right through you like we always do. Oh, yeah, this year, we the MVP. This year, we the first round draft pick. This year, we the all-star team. This year, we the starters. You on the sideline.
Yes, sir.
That's the difference between you and us. We know how to adapt. We evolve, we move with the game. While y'all sitting there stuck in the past 5 years, the future's standing right in front of you, boy. Fastlane at WrestleMania. Welcome!
5 years? 5 years in the past, have the two of you lost your mind? We've been at the top where we belong. We've been kicking down doors. We've been breaking bears. We've been setting records. We hosted WrestleMania when the two of you were in the back eating catering. And at Fastlane, we take what is currently yours and become not the one time, not the two time, not three or four, but five time WWE World Tag Team Champions. And there's not a damn thing either of you can do about it.
You know, what I appreciate the most about the Usos over the years, and them being my favorite tag team for the company over the last 5 years, is just that you feel the passion of what they do. And, you know, you get your stereotypes about the Samoans getting handed things because their family were in the business and this and that, but they put in that work. They put in that work. And I appreciate the hustle these guys put in. You know, these guys were young fathers. They didn't have the chance to finish college. They're in a rough place, and they're in a rough situation. I recommend you guys to go check out that 24 special on Usos. I think it was the very first one that they did. And it brought to light of where the Usos were as performers and as men and how they evolved over the years. And they do deserve a spot at WrestleMania. I don't say that a lot for a lot of performances. I think the word deserves and this and that. And this has to be right or this is horrid booking or anything like that. That stuff doesn't really matter to me. But I think when you look at what the Usos did this past year with the character change and the rivalry with the New Day and these matches they put on with the Bar at the Survivor Series and et cetera, et cetera. These guys deserve an opportunity to be on the main show. And whether that's in a fatal four-way, triple threat, or whatever multi-person tag team match it is, I'm fine with it. But I always make an exception. I think the Usos do deserve an opportunity to be on the main WrestleMania show. So I really enjoyed that program there with the Usos and the New Day. We'll see if we'll get any additions to that match. I posed the idea of possibly Gable and Benjamin going in there as a three-way match. We'll see next week. Speaking of labbing on SmackDown, I thought SmackDown was really good this week. A lot of people have been knocking SmackDown for its quality over the last couple weeks and months. I talked about the challenges of producing content like that for 7 weeks when you're separating separate brand pay-per-views, and then you have a big four show, and then you gotta wait seven weeks to the next SmackDown pay-per-view. It can be a challenge, and it's not easy to write television this week. Not every show is going to be great. You know, you like to have more hits than misses. And I thought SmackDown this week from LA was really good. And you saw John Cena go in there, and now John Cena will be part of the men's six-pack challenge for the WWE title at Fastlane. You got Baron Corbin, Dolph Ziggler, Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn, AJ Styles, and John Cena. And that's going to be the main event of this pay-per-view coming up a week from this Sunday in Columbus, Ohio. So, Fastlane is our final, like, main pay-per-view before WrestleMania, which is cool. So, we get ready, get that show out of the way, and we go straight down to New Orleans. That's what we prepare for. And, I'll cover that pay-per-view live on my website, ProWrestlingTranscriptions.com. You check that out. And other stuff on the show, that I thought Naomi and Ruby Riott was okay. It wasn't the greatest match. It wasn't the worst either. They did get a lot of time. They're prepping up Ruby a lot for opportunity for her to go against Charlotte for the SmackDown Women's title. You know, it's very interesting. I saw Ruby Riott perform a lot of times at AEW over the years in Berwyn, and she was just a young performer getting her start in the business, you know, and now she's taking on Ric Flair's daughter at a pay-per-view. I think that's very, very cool. So I'm happy for Ruby that she's going to get the opportunity. Next week on this podcast, we'll make our predictions for the Fastlane pay-per-view a week from this Sunday. So, You know the drill here by now. When it comes to the Raw and SmackDown recaps, I don't need to go blow by blow every segment. I thought the stuff with Shane McMahon and Daniel Bryan added some more context this week. I mentioned this in this Periscope chat I did the other day, and I like that they're doing this feud with Daniel Bryan and Shane McMahon, but I want to see more layers to it, and I think that started this past week with Shane kind of throwing those indirect jabs about Daniel Bryan's wife, and you're adding more of that tension that way, where you saw that backstage segment with him and Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn, and they're like, yeah, you know, Daniel Bryan is your guy, and Brie would be mad if you guys missed dinner. So I think more tension will be brewing through these guys, especially after the Fastlane pay-per-view. Something's going to happen. I don't know if we're going to get a match or a fight or something, but something's got to give. And it's either going to be Shane McMahon or Daniel Bryan that's going to snap. So we'll see what happens. And then lastly, something on the show that stood out to me. Like I mentioned, the Usos and New Day promo was very good. We're going to get Bobby Roode against Randy Orton for the United States title for the first time at Fastlane, which I think will be a very good match. And I'm trying to remember what else. Oh, I thought Baron Corbin and Sami Zayn had a very good match. I thought that was fine. And Nakamura got a nice little TV victory over Aiden English. And It looks. I originally thought it was gonna be Cena and Nakamura, at that show, at Fastlane, but that's not the case. So, I talked about this a couple weeks ago. I don't think you need Nakamura to be on Fastlane. We know Nakamura's path to WrestleMania. He's not putting that spot on the line, so you don't need him on Fastlane. So, overall, I enjoyed SmackDown for top to bottom. I thought it was a very good show. One of the better ones in the last couple weeks. And coming up this upcoming week, we have the go-home show before Fastlane. And then coming here next week on the podcast, I'll give you my predictions for that upcoming pay-per-view. All right, guys, one last break. We'll take a look back at this past week's Raw from Anaheim, California, and put a ribbon and a bow on this podcast for this week. You're listening to the Josh Lopez Wrestling Podcast.
Seth, what do you make of Finn Balor following your footsteps and beating The Miz tonight?
To be honest, Renee, I don't really know what he's trying to prove. Upstaging me or something? He comes out, beats a guy that I just beat. That's not how you make your mark. That's not how you prove you're the man. You want to make a mark and prove you're the man, you do what I did last week. You last 65 minutes in the gauntlet match. That's how you make this place Monday Night Rollins.
With a very impressive victory tonight, but last night you did come up short in the chamber. So where exactly does that leave you for WrestleMania?
Yeah, you know what? I did come up short last night. But one thing I've learned over the years is that there's more than one road to WrestleMania. And if history is any indicator, I know how to pave my way to WrestleMania. I want The Miz and the Intercontinental Championship, and I want it at WrestleMania.
Finn, first of all, congratulations on the victory tonight. Now, after your match, Seth Rollins had a lot to say, but the main thing that he was saying is that he's the one that deserves the opportunity at the Intercontinental Championship at WrestleMania. How do you respond to that?
Classic Seth Rollins, a lot to say. I heard he said something about 65 minutes in a gauntlet match. He didn't go 65 minutes in a gauntlet match with me. He may have beaten The Miz, but Finn Balor beat The Miz too. So Seth Rollins wants to go to WrestleMania to challenge for the Intercontinental title. He's going to have to go through me. Comprende?
Miz, can we get a word? Miz, obviously, disappointing night
I'm
for you.
I'm trying to have a moment with my wife. Did I not give enough out there? Was 1 hour not enough? Two matches that I don't even think I should have had. Shouldn't I already have a WrestleMania match? Haven't I done enough?
Yes, you have.
Haven't I done enough?
You do it all.
Am I a good guy? Why am I being punished? What did I do? The only thing I've done is make this the most prestigious and honorable title in all of WWE. I am the second longest reigning Intercontinental Champion of all time. I have been here for 12 years. I have done everything. Everything that WWE has asked and more. And out there, I'm the star of the Marine movie franchise. I'm the star of the sensational TV hit Miz and Mrs. It's coming out. I'm filming right now. No one will leave me alone. But yet, I don't get the respect I deserve. Why?
Speaking of WrestleMania matches, Seth Rollins says that he feels like he deserves a match
deserves?
For...
I deserve to be in the main event of WrestleMania. But you know what? Kurt Angle isn't going to allow that to happen. But it doesn't matter what Kurt Angle thinks. Because this, no matter what, will be the main event of WrestleMania. It will be the talk of WrestleMania. Now, if you excuse me, I'm going to have a moment.
You guys want to know the truth? They're not going to like it back there, but I'm going to say it anyways. Brock Lesnar's not here tonight. Up until about 30 minutes ago, I thought Brock was going to be here, but something happened or the other, and he didn't show. And nobody will say this back there, but I'm going to say it. Brock Lesnar is an entitled piece of crap who hides behind his contract. We are 6 weeks from WrestleMania, and the Universal Champion is not here today. We were in Vegas last night. Brock was in Vegas. He wasn't at the Elimination Chamber. Guess where he was? He was running around the strip taking pictures with Dana White and the UFC on social media. You want to know why? Because he doesn't respect me. He doesn't respect any of you. And he doesn't respect anybody in that locker room. And I'm sick of it. We're all sick of it. They all know it back there. We all know it. Every single week, me and them boys run across this world and we bust our ass. And Brock just shows up whenever he wants to, when the money's right or the city's right. But we don't care. It doesn't matter how many people show up, how big the town is, I'll be there. Because I said I'll be there. And Brock and Paul, don't worry, they're gonna come out here and say, we're businessmen. Well, guess what? I was born in this business. My family and my bloodline is this business. And I was taught at an early age that there's a fine line between business and respect. And I say this right now. I don't respect Brock Lesnar. And I damn sure don't fear that. I think I've said enough now. I'm gonna go and head to the back, take my ass chewing like a man, because unlike some people, I actually care and respect this place.
Gentlemen, okay, so in the Discord chat, something set me off and I got quiet. So somebody, I don't remember who it was, said that the Roman Reigns headlining full WrestleMania is the same thing as Hulk Hogan headlining. Well, I'm sorry, but Hulk Hogan headlined three WrestleManias in a row, but he did it because he was over. He was part of the WrestleMania 4 main event. He was not in the match, but he was there. But he was there because he was over. And people cheered and were happy to see him. He headlined 5 and 6 because people wanted to see him, and it was a big deal. The first WrestleMania he wasn't a part of was WrestleMania 10. So, yeah, Hogan wrestled. He was headlining all these WrestleManias because the fans wanted to see Hulk Hogan. The fans are sick and tired of seeing Roman Reigns headlining WrestleMania. If Roman Reigns was getting the reaction of Hulk Hogan, this conversation would not be happening. But he's not.
I agree.
And the fact that you build up Braun Strowman and you give him all these awesome moments, all like for the last 10 months, all these amazing moments, you guys were just talking about it, and then you shit on it. Just you let him beat 5 guys in Elimination Chamber, 5 established superstars. You beat them, and then you give that moment to Reigns because you had it written in concrete that he had to fight Brock Lesnar this year. This is garbage. I was on the verge of buying WrestleMania tickets this year, and if they don't change direction, and I really don't want people to lose their jobs, I don't want people to get suspended, but I really hope this steroid thing has some teeth to it, and we don't get to see Roman Reigns headline another WrestleMania, and they can change course correct this and give Braun that match against Brock, because that's the match people want to see. They don't want to see Roman Reigns anymore.
And then wins. And the issue that I have with this particular win is that as a ticket holder for my 4th straight WrestleMania, I need a break. I need a break because I've walked into every single WrestleMania that I've attended having everybody hate the main event. And it's awful because he's not even in the title match in one of them, but it's going on last and everybody hates it.
Uh-huh.
And WWE, this is a plea to you. I need you to understand that we get it. He's a part of the plan. And I'm not asking... He is the plan. He's the plan, right? I get it. But force-feeding this down everybody's throat is going to turn people away. And you've built up so much goodwill with everybody. With everybody that... just take this guy off of this spot for 1 year. 1 year is all I'm asking.
So, to expound on that, and the lines are open, 508-202-1624. We're talking all things Elimination Chamber with you. Ronda Rousey, the women's match, which was excellent. The tag match, Nia Jax versus Asuka, which was also very good. The men, of course, the road to WrestleMania ahead of us. Anything from Raw and the Elimination Chamber is on the table. We're taking your calls at 508-202-1624, 508-202-1NAI. So it kind of allowed me to expound on that, I guess, because you and I have been to the same amount of WrestleManias and the same WrestleManias. When I was a kid, this show, WrestleMania, was the one guarantee that if you fell into the vocal, well, I have to use that word, I guess, majority, that you were going to go home happy. Hulk Hogan, now again, I understand that there's yeah buts to this. Hulk Hogan sent you home happy a bunch of times. One time he didn't. You didn't want him to steal Bret's thunder. Agreed. But most of the time, Hulk Hogan sent you home happy. Then Shawn Michaels sent you home happy. Then Steve Austin sent you home happy. Then, like, The Rock sent you home happy. For the beginning, John Cena did. And then I understand that that's where the parallels have to start, because then John Cena did main event a bunch of WrestleManias that, to be fair to Roman Reigns, didn't send people home happy. But the difference here is this, and I think it needs to really be touched upon, is at the time that John Cena was rocket shipping, it was the Chris Benoit damage control, right? So we had to rocket ship him because he was the face of the rebranding of the family-friendly, please don't think about us when you think about Chris Benoit, WWE, right? So we had to kind of put our fingers in our ears through from 2007 to 2010-ish and just go, la, 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 I don't care, la, 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 right? Okay, fine. But then what happened, the other side of it was, when you got sick of John Cena right around that Rock period, I know you wanted CM Punk, okay, gotcha. But CM Punk around 2011 was the first guy that actually emerged as somebody they might be able to sell even close to as well as they were going to sell, as they had been selling John Cena. But the point is that I don't think there was a ton. I don't think in 2011 and 2012 they were very talented, the roster.
No.
So when it's John Cena, it's like, look, are there guys we could use here, but they're nowhere close to John.
Right.
Right? And now, with Roman Reigns being a member of a roster, with Finn Balor, Seth Rollins, Braun Strowman, this feels like, okay, like you said, don't shelve him. I told you I would have him win the tag team titles.
Right.
So he still wins something with a guy you like.
Miz is going to be having a baby.
Yeah.
Have him win the Intercontinental title and defend it at WrestleMania.
Something like that. This was the year that it felt to me that we have the roster, so you can't throw that in my face, Vince, about why it's Roman Reigns. And this company has already gotten on its feet with its new identity. And part of helping establish that new identity, quite frankly, would be if Finn Balor was in this match. That's the guy I keep going back to over and over again in my head. Because there were actual wrestling reasons why Braun Strowman shouldn't be the one to beat Brock Lesnar. There were real wrestling reasons for that. But there are no goddamn good reasons why Finn Balor shouldn't be in the Raw main event.
And the worst part about all of this, right, is that WWE, at the end of that show, you showed me that you understand what's happening, which makes this even more infuriating.
You booked the Royal Rumble a certain way because you knew it would help Nakamura's pop.
Right.
Because he threw out this
and
guy.
And you built this match a certain way because you knew it would keep up the drama. And then he wins, right? Which is, you don't get it. But then you understand what's happening because Braun Strowman immediately gets up and destroys Roman Reigns.
Uh-huh.
And the show ends with Roman Reigns lying in a heap in front of the WrestleMania sign. That's not good enough because you've told me that you understand in that moment.
Yep.
Because
Braun
Strowman destroying Roman Reigns makes everybody go home happy.
Here's the thing about Roman Reigns, right? And we're going to talk about all things Chamber. I know we already have a call, and we're going to open it up. Because I promise, sometimes it might feel like it, but we don't use these airwaves to bury Roman Reigns. You're never going to listen to a New Age Insider show where we tell you the guy's an untalented loser, or go away forever, or fire the guy. Never, ever, ever, ever. But the reality that people need to now start seeing, even if you're a huge, giant Roman Reigns fan, right, which is fine. If this is your dude, then that's your dude.
That's,
my dude's Goldberg.
That's fine.
That came with controversy, too.
Better analogy. My guy's Triple H.
Yeah.
All right? Everybody talks about how Triple H buries all of these young talent,
right,
and is consistently putting himself over. Triple H.
And everybody thought my guy sucked.
Right.
And
but Triple H, with all of his power, all of his clout, and all of the reputation, never main evented 4 straight WrestleManias.
Yep.
Never.
And so here's the point. I'm going to open it up to the call and just start rolling with him at 508-202-1624. Well, you got to understand, Roman Reigns fans, from our perspective, from, you know, people that are less than pleased with the Roman Reigns experience, is he is all the infuriating parts of Hogan and Cena, the no-selling,
yep,
the constant winning on the big stage. And people are going to start tweeting me things that show that, you know, actually Roman only won like 47% of his televised. Doesn't matter. When it's go time, he wins them all.
Right.
He does.
Right.
And
he lost everything leading up to this match.
And
now,
is still somehow the number one contender, even though we have spent a lot of time and energy making 3 other people look better than him.
Yeah.
Strowman, Rollins, and Finn Balor. And so
even the Drifter.
So and we'll get to the call. The infuriating parts of Cena were no selling, winning every big match, and never giving somebody else their year.
It's his yard now. It'll become through fruition in New Orleans at the Mercedes-Benz Superdome. Finally, we'll get rid of this Brock Lesnar hogging, glowing, attitude era, clinging on bullshit era is over. You know, you hear those clips right there, and my goal for this segment was to have to respond in the way Roman Reigns would to this segment. And, you know, how he did, how he responded to the crowd trashing him the night after WrestleMania. And he said those 3 words: it's his yard now. It is his yard now. Listen to that. They're telling you that Roman Reigns is the roadblock from this era getting his identity. Which, it's not true. It's the other way around. Brock Lesnar is the roadblock for this company to find its new identity. The unfortunate thing is the guy to put out Roman Reigns is a guy that you don't want. Deal with it. I'd rather have Brock Lesnar out of the company and give it homegrown talent opportunity to have that spotlight than have this guy still clinging on so we can sell more ads for the WWE Network for the Attitude Era and act like we're going to go back to TV-14 wrestling. That's the truth. Roman Reigns is not the guy the hardcore fans want. And guess what? They keep making money in spite of it. It's business. It's smart business. It's smart entertainment business. You can have your opinions, yet you still watch. You can whine on your shows, yet you still watch. You could tweet, you can Instagram, you can Snapchat, you can MyFace all your venom for WWE, yet you still watch. And you still watch because Roman Reigns is the guy. With that said, thank you guys so much for checking out episode 95 of the Josh Lopez Wrestling Podcast. Make sure to like it, hit it, subscribe, review on Apple Podcasts and my YouTube channel. Make sure to tell a friend about the show, spread it around. We're all social media platforms. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at NotoriousYoshi. Send me an email, prowrestlingtranscriptions@gmail.com, bookmark prowrestlingtranscriptions.com. Shout out to the good brother Adam Daly. I got a couple of shout outs I need to give out as well because I had a couple questions come in today from the good brothers. One for Derrico, brother Carter at Derrico06. His question was, who's the most over superstar in WWE right now and why? Well, Brother Carter, I told you when you sent me this message that I was going to give you this answer at the beginning. Well, guess what, buddy? Now it's at the end of the show. And I think that segment that we just played right there explains why. Roman Reigns is still the most over superstar in WWE. And right there is why. Second question that I got was from another friend of mine at Twitter, at Patrick Fritz, at Rated PWF, so you can follow him at Twitter. What do you see as the end game for the Mixed Match Challenge? Does the lead WWE to maybe make it a championship based on a format? I just think it's a nice project to give. Is this a good project to give it a shot? I don't think this is something where WWE is going to attach their programming to Facebook more. This is a trial thing. Give it a shot. And they're making the most of it. The shows are fun. I don't have a problem covering the Mixed Match Challenges. It's a good time covering those shows. So I think the end game is to give new talents a different chance to develop their characters in a different environment. And I think they're making the best of it. So that's my thoughts on the Mixed Match Challenge. Remember the two questions I sent to you at the beginning of the show. What constitutes today's modern wrestling fan in 2018? And the second question is, why would a man need to speak for a woman, or Ronda Rousey in that matter? Why would a man need to speak for a woman in wrestling? With that said, my name is Josh Lopez. This has been episode 95 of the Josh Lopez Wrestling Podcast. The goal of this show is to give you God honest truth, and I speak from my heart. I thank you for giving this show a chance. Support the good brothers at Rant With Ant. My boy Adam Daly at Twitter, AdamDaly13. My boy Jonathan Hood, who was on the podcast last week, at TweetJHood and IGJHood on Instagram. We'll be back here next week to preview Fastlane. Remember, you're the director of your life story. Never let anybody impugn your character or your integrity. I love you guys. Live your voice. Be your voice. I'm out.